Okay, now we will start the RF device technology short courses. And first, I would like to introduce this excellent course organizer, Dr. Bin Zhao. And he organized all of these lectures. And he received his BS degrees in electronic engineering from Tsuyuan University in China, 1985. And he received a PhD from Applied Physics from California Institute of Technology in 1988. So, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of all the short course speakers, it is our great pleasure to welcome you to this 2002 IEDM short course, RF Device Technology for Communication Systems. Before we start the detailed presentation, I'd like to go over some introduction material so that you will have a good understanding about the background, motivation, objective and arrangement of this short course. Today, communication influences our daily life in many ways. Communication is to deliver information from information sender to information user, where the information can be voice, audio, data, image, and video. The communication task is accomplished by a communication system which contains three basic elements: transmitter, receiver, and a communication channel. Depending on applications, the communication channel can be wireline, wireless, or optical media. The ultimate goal of a communication system is to transfer information from one place to another quickly and efficiently. In a communication system, a series of signal processing are needed. At the transmitter, it may include the signal coding and modulation before the signal is launched into a communication channel. At the receiver, you need a reverse process, which includes the signal demodulation and decoding to recover the original message signal. The reason to do this sometimes sophisticated signal processing is to overcome the deficiencies related to the channel, such as signal attenuation, noise, interference, and signal distortion. According to the classical Shannon information capacity theorem, the maximum information transfer rate without error is equal to the allocated channel bandwidth times log base 2, 1 plus signal to noise ratio at the receiver. Shannon's theorem shows a theoretical upper bound for a communication rate. It clearly indicates the two communication resources, channel bandwidth and signal power, one need to manage in a communication system. Communication technologies are the art to efficiently use these two resources through various signal processing at the transmitter and the receiver to maximum the information transfer rate and make it approach Shannon limit. Communication technology are leading a revolution in the world both economically and socially right now. There are two factors which have made this revolution a reality. The first one is the advance in digital signal processing. DSP, together with the data conversion technology, has made it possible to perform various needed signal processing in digital domain rather than in analog domain. This makes the signal processing much more reliable and repeatable. Along with the digital logic IC technology scaling and advancement, DSP IC have made these signal processing done quicker, cheaper, and in an integrated fashion. The other factor making the modern communication revolution possible is the development of various advanced modulation techniques. These advanced modulation techniques are the foundations for many communication standards and protocols which have made the communication more efficient, affordable, and manageable. Now, what's the role played by the RF technology in this revolution? Communication can be categorized into two kinds. The first is the passband signal communication. In this case, the bandwidth of interest signal is much less than the RF frequency. By mixing with the RF carrier, the baseband signal is transferred to the RF frequency while roughly maintain its narrow bandwidth before transmission. This scheme is widely used in wireless communications in order to facilitate signal transmission, receiving, modulation, and channel management. The second kind of communication deal with baseband signal directly. Thus, it is named as baseband signal communication. In broadband high-speed internet application, the baseband signal bandwidth can be brought into the RF frequency domain for high data rate. So the role played by RF technology are different in these two communication schemes. One need to deal with narrowband signal and frequency transfer, and the other one need to handle wideband signal. The broadband RF technology have led to explosive deployment of high-speed internet in the past several years. For narrowband RF communications, in addition to the traditional radio and TV broadcasting, many exciting applications have shown up in bidirectional and interactive wireless communications. As shown by this slide, these wireless communications including GPS, global position system, satellite communications, wireless phone, Bluetooth, which is a personal area network solution, wireless LAN, which stands for wireless local area network, and is the last mile extension of the internet, and the smart handheld devices. This slide showed the wireless communication evolution for cellular system and wireless LAN. Each box shows the corresponding wireless standard name, the modulation scheme, RF carrier frequency, channel bandwidth, and user data rate. From this slide, you can clearly see there's two trends exist here. First, as the data rate increase, the channel bandwidth increase. This is easy to understand from Shannon's theorem. Keeping everything else the same, high data rate need a larger channel bandwidth. The challenge here is that the existing narrowband wireless RF technology may not work well for the increased channel bandwidth in the future. Another trend here is that for the new emerging applications, the RF frequency need to go to higher unused frequency band in order to avoid interference and to achieve the desired performance. The increase in carrier frequency represents another challenge for the next generation RF communications. A key factor to this wireless communication revolution is the development of integrated IC solutions which can overcome these technical challenges at affordable cost. This chart shows the key IC component in a digital cellular phone. These IC components have occupied and will continue to occupy a sizable share in the total semiconductor market. This chart shows the semiconductor IC market forecast for cellular personal communication systems. The projected worldwide cellular PCS handset shipment will pass 600 million units in year 2006. And the corresponding semiconductor revenue is predicted to have a compound annual growth rate of 18% over the next 5 years. This market sector represents about 15% of the total worldwide semiconductor revenue. Among these revenues, about one-third are generated by RF integrated circuit. Of course, RF communication is more than just cellular system. This slide shows the market trend for wireless LAN. The chipset shipment will grow 5 times in 5 years, and the corresponding semiconductor revenue will have 29% compound annual growth rate over the next 5 years. With this kind of growth, there are a lot of opportunities for RF devices and integrated circuits. Looking at a generic wireless communication system, the RF subsystem, which includes low noise amplifier, power amplifier, frequency synthesizer, and frequency converters, is a critical link between the signal processing units and the air channel interface. Integrated circuit and device technologies supporting these RF subsystems are the focus of this short course. In order for the IC chips to provide the required functionality of RF subsystem at affordable cost, an important task is to select a suitable architecture for specific applications. Another important task is the performance trade-offs in device and circuit design and product implementation. In addition, understanding the technology options, the pro and the con for different devices and materials will help to reach an optimal solution in terms of cost, power consumption, time to market, and other considerations which have been listed on this slide. We hope this short course will provide you some insight on all these aspects. Today, we are fortunate to have 5 leading experts from both academia and industry to lecture at this short course. They will share with us their expertise, experience, and insight on all different aspects of RF integrated circuit and technologies. First, Professor Abidi from UCLA will talk about RF subsystem architecture. Professor Larry Larson from UCSD will review the RF circuit building blocks and their requirement for RF devices. Dr. David Harami from IBM will discuss the current status and the future trend in RF device technologies. Professor Schroeter from Dresden University of Technology will talk about the modeling for RF devices and circuit design. Finally, Dr. Dominic Linards from Philip will talk about RFIC circuit design and implementation considerations. This is the short course schedule, and we will have 2 lectures this morning and 3 lectures in the afternoon. With this introduction, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Asad Abidi from UCLA. Professor Abidi is a well-known expert in design of analog and RF integrated circuit. He received his PhD from UC Berkeley. He worked at Bell Labs before he joined UCLA, where he is a professor with the Electrical Engineering Department. He has received numerous awards Among them are 1997 IEEE Donald Fink Award and IEEE Millennium Medal. He's a fellow of IEEE. Today, he will talk about modern RF communication and architecture. Now, please welcome Professor Abidi.
Thank you, Ben. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A broad swept course like this on the subject of RF is always a bit of a challenge, particularly given the set of excellent lecturers. And so I had to make some choices in what I would cover in my part. I think given the large technology audience here, I wanted to focus on some of the system-inspired issues that relate to devices on modern integrated RF transceivers. And I'd like to steer away from the well-understood issues which have to do with low noise figure, or high FT, FMAX, the difficulties of making inductors and so on, because those are well covered by the other lecturers. Instead, I'd like to talk about some of the issues of high levels of integration and some of the other component challenges that arise as a result, such as the matching of elements, the impact of offsets, the impact of flicker noise, particularly in all CMOS implementations, which are becoming more commercially important now, and so on. So just as been summarized, there is a broad spectrum of wireless applications today, and they fall roughly into these categories. You have cellular telephones, which are clearly the market leader in wireless devices. For instance, GSM and its variants that operate in the 900 or 1800 megahertz band. In addition, CDMA is gaining currency, and the two standards are IS-95 today and CDMA 2000 emerging. For data communications, there is the exciting new field of wireless LAN, which offers some prospects of commercial hope in today's rather gloomy marketplace. And there, IEEE 802.11 A and B are the prevailing standards, with Bluetooth being a more sort of an older, a lower bitrate standard that is still of commercial interest. And then we have specialized devices such as radio paging, where simple messages are sent, and these are often one-way receive-only devices. Now, this table summarizes some of the features of these things, and I'll just focus on a few things. In GSM 900 and 1800, which specifies the operating frequency bands, the typical modulation that is used is called Gaussian minimum shift keying, which is a constant envelope modulation, which makes it relatively easy to both detect the signal and, most importantly, to generate it at the transmitter. The maximum power that the mobile puts out is about 1 watt, and I would like to start the remaining presentation by focusing on some of the issues of transmission, because, again, reception is usually well covered and transmission tends to get a little neglected. The data rates that this covers today only focus on voice band stuff, but the standards allow for relatively high data rates of 270 kilobits per second, and this is all fit into existing channel bandwidths of 200 kilohertz. In CDMA 2000, the frequency band of operation is 1.8 to 2 gigahertz, and here a more sophisticated modulation scheme, quadrature phase shift keying, is used with direct sequence spread spectrum, again transmitting up to 1 watt. And the challenges in the power amplifier here are considerably greater because we no longer have the benefit of constant envelope modulation. So the power amplifier, instead of being a nonlinear, highly efficient one, must now become more linear and therefore less efficient. And that poses very severe restrictions on battery life. This can handle data rates of 144 and up to 600 kilobits per second, making the standard suitable for simultaneous voice and data transmission. And the channel bandwidths are expanded from 200 kilohertz up to 1.25 megahertz. Then in the wireless LAN area, the emerging standard is 802.11a, which operates in the 5 gigahertz band. And this uses an array of different modulation schemes which are adaptively selected depending on the prevailing channel conditions. They can be anywhere from binary phase shift keying to quadrature and then up to quadrature amplitude modulation. The transmitted powers span from 60 milliwatts up to 1 watt, and the data rates can be anywhere from 6 up to 54 megabits per second, occupying channels as wide as 20 megahertz after spread spectrum. 802.11b is the precursor, which works at the 2.4 gigahertz band and delivers somewhat lower data rates. And Bluetooth is a short link cable replacement wireless technology that was targeted to develop only up to 1 megabit per second, transmitting powers as low as 1 milliwatt and up to 100 milliwatts, and using a relatively constant envelope modulation. So what we find is that the frequency ranges of interest today are anywhere from 900 megahertz to 5 gigahertz, well within the compass of all major mainstream IC technologies for all the RF sections. The channel bandwidths are from a few hundred kilohertz up to 20 megahertz wide, and for this poses the challenge for the baseband sections and for the A to D converters. And again, these are well within the capabilities of tried and tested baseband circuits. There is nothing that is pushing the envelope in difficulty. However, it's when we, let's start by looking at some of the issues of the power amplifier, because again, this is something we tend to underappreciate. Now, constant envelope modulations, such as frequency shift keying or its variance, are precisely that. All the information is coded in instantaneous phase or frequency fluctuations. This means that in the linearity of the sending power amplifier is not important, because you might as well be sending a square wave effectively, which is filtered out at the antenna, and all the information is contained in the zero crossings. However, as we fit in much higher data rates into slightly wider channels, we must use more sophisticated modulation schemes, such as quadrature phase shift keying, and then superimposed upon that for multiple user OFDM. And the resulting waveforms are far from constant envelope. This is a 5x4 differential QPSK waveform. 25 symbols are indicated here. And what we see is fluctuations in the envelope, which must be faithfully reproduced by the power amplifier. And in this case, this is specified by the peak to average power ratio, the peak being the instantaneous peak, the average being the RMS of this. And in this case, it's about 3.5 dB. When we go to a 802.11a type broadcast or a transmitted waveform, we can be dealing with much more sophisticated amplitude modulation with 64 levels, further compounded by the difficulties of orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. And the final output waveform looks like this. And you can see a much greater range of fluctuation in the envelope. So if we start by looking at the typical power amplifiers that we use for constant envelope modulation, they would consist of usually a very simple circuit, a single transistor even with some matching elements attached, which has naturally a saturating characteristic because it's swinging as large as the supply voltage allows to transmit the, let's say, the 1 watt type of power level. This sort of saturating characteristic is often captured by this empirical relationship, which is called the wrap relationship, where a parameter P captures the hardness of the saturation. The efficiency of this power amplifier is of great interest, because if you send out a watt, but you're working, let's say, at 25% efficiency, you will draw 4 watts from the supply voltage, which is inevitably a battery. So we need to keep this efficiency high so that the battery is not discharged quickly. And for a simple amplifier like this, which draws all the current that is supplied to the load from the supply, the efficiency is defined as the output power delivered to the load relative to the power taken from the supply voltage, and this amounts to the ratio of the output voltage swing peak divided by the supply voltage. So for fixed supply voltage, the efficiency improves with output amplitude, and in general, the power amplifier is most efficient as it approaches saturation. Now, to drive something in saturation for high efficiency is okay with constant envelope modulation. But for variable envelope waveforms, like I showed you earlier, this would be quite unsuitable. In constant envelope power amplifiers, putting out a watt or so, efficiencies of 75% and higher are quite commonplace today. Now, when we apply a variable envelope waveform to even a mildly nonlinear amplifier, there are many problems that crop up. One of them is spectral spreading or regrowth. Let's take the simple example of a saturating characteristic, whether it's the power amplifier or any other circuit, described by a polynomial, which of course contains a third order distortion and higher terms. And we'll subject it to a variable envelope sine wave, where the variable envelope is specified by this modulation parameter. This corresponds to AM sidebands driving this power amplifier. Now, when it is when this waveform enters a nonlinear amplifier here, we see at the output of the nonlinear amplifier the amplified version of the two principal side tones appearing, which are given by this relationship. And in addition, second order and third order terms, or rather additional side tones, that appear from the distortion process. And this causes the overall bandwidth occupied by the output signal to expand into neighboring channels. Now, this must be limited by specifications, which are typically given by some kind of transmit mask like this, which says that if the main channel lies in this bandwidth here and you're transmitting this power, you are allowed to leak into the adjacent and the alternate adjacent channel by certain amounts which are lower than the maximum transmitted power. And this is the biggest channel in linear power amplifier design to abide by these specifications in the presence of nonlinearity. Now, the way that linearity is dealt with is by making sure that the signal that is being sent does not drive the power into high levels of saturation. And this is characterized by backoff, which means that the peak value of the signal is kept well below the saturation level, while the practical power amplifier, which always saturates, stays well below its saturation level. The greater the backoff, you get higher linearity, but lower efficiency, because as I mentioned earlier, efficiency rises with the output swing as you approach saturation. So if you back off from saturation, the efficiency declines. This gives a practical example for a power amplifier characterized by a wrap parameter P equal to 3, which has been backed off by 6.3 dB at the output, and it is transmitting OFDM, like 802.11a waveforms, with 256 subcarriers. Theoretically, from a perfectly linear power amplifier, this is what you would expect, a compact spectrum that occupies no more than the specified channel. However, because of power amplifier nonlinearity and the spectral regrowth process I described earlier, the actual spectrum overlaps into adjacent channels, and there are limits to how much it can do so. So, depending on how much the backoff is, one can estimate what the efficiency would be. And there is a simple model like this, which says that the more the backoff, the lower the efficiency, with some typical parameters shown here. And for this particular power amplifier, the efficiency at this 6.3 dB backoff declines to only 20%. That means that the power amplifier runs hot and the battery discharges quickly. Now, in this regard, both device improvements are valuable in that you have fewer parasitic losses that the power amplifier transistor itself suffers from. And circuit improvements are important so that we use the best possible way to drive the power amplifier. Other lecturers will talk about the device issues. I'd like to touch on the circuit challenges. Let's start by looking at the conventional way of making transmitters. A totally general purpose transmitter is shown here, and this is to be found, for example, in conventional GSM handsets. We start with synthesizing the waveform to be transmitted in quadrature phases, which I'll describe in a little while as to why they're important, digitally. Then D2A converters convert those to analog waveforms in quadrature, which are upconverted in this simple case by a single local oscillator oscillating at the final output transmit frequency in quadrature phases. Two mixers mix quadrature phases of the local oscillator with quadrature phases of the modulation at baseband and upconvert it into a single sideband, which is then amplified, possibly filtered, and drives the power amplifier. The GSM system uses a different band to transmit than to receive, so the two can share a common antenna through a duplexer. Now, this is an example of direct upconversion to RF. The power amplifier can be a saturated class B type power amplifier because it's constant envelope modulation. Some of the limitations of the scheme are that wide band noise at baseband is also upconverted with the signal and amplified, so that not only do we have a strong, let's say, 1 watt signal coming in, but a strongly amplified wideband noise that is spewing out across the transmit band from the antenna. And that can, in principle, encroach upon the receive band, which is slightly offset in frequency, and the amplified noise from one transmitter can overwhelm the receive sensitivity of a nearby handset that is trying to receive a weak desired signal. As a result, the duplexer is necessary, which is essentially a filter that filters out wideband emissions from here that might enter the receive band. However, any duplexer, even in its passband, suffers from some insertion loss. That means that even if this is designed to pass signals here, the signal may be attenuated, let's take an extreme example, by 3 dB. That means that half the power that this power amplifier has worked so hard to create would be dissipated in the duplexer itself, and the remaining half would go out of the antenna. And that's a serious limitation. In addition, mismatches in the gains of the I and Q channels, as well as phase imperfections in quadrature, can cause parasitic amplitude modulation to appear at this point, which, through the nonlinearity of the power amplifier, can cause spectral regrowth and encroachment into adjacent channels in the transmit band. That also is undesirable. Finally, in a simple system like this, there is a very practical problem that the signal coming out here is a modulated signal, modulated in frequency, whereas the signal used to upconvert the baseband is a pure sine wave in quadrature phases, tuned to exactly the channel that the output is being transmitted at. If there is any form of parasitic coupling from the output, whether it's from the output of the power amplifier, on chip, on board, or even through the antenna, back towards the local oscillator, a modulated signal goes and starts to perturb the local oscillator by a spurious injection locking, this being modulated in frequency, this being intended to be stable. And this parasitic remodulation can distort the output completely. Now, some of these problems can be overcome by using what has now become the standard GSM transmitter architecture, the offset frequency loop. Here, the same quadrature signals at baseband are upconverted in the same way that I showed you, but to an intermediate frequency. And so what we have is a FSK signal here containing frequency shift information as we want it, but not at the final RF frequency, rather at some intermediate frequency. And then this intermediate frequency is finally upconverted to the 900 megahertz band using a phase-locked loop with a mixer in the feedback. What this does is cause a frequency translation in feedback so that the intermediate frequency here is essentially translated or shifted to the final desired frequency through this phase-locked loop. Now, the main point here is that the object that drives the power amplifier is no longer the output of two D2A converters with parasitic amplitude modulation as a possibility, but rather a VCO in the phase lock loop, which is guaranteed to have a constant envelope because you cannot perturb the envelope of a VCO through PLL action. So we are guaranteed constant envelope here, and therefore no spectral regrowth due to parasitic amplitude modulation. Also, the output noise of the VCO naturally tends to fall off by the nature of phase noise and is also limited by the relatively narrow loop bandwidth of the phase lock loop. This means that we are not spewing out wideband noise that might go into the receive path, and a simple switch instead of a duplexer filter can be used so that we are not, we know for sure that as we transmit, we're not also putting out wideband noise that'll go into the receive band. This elimination of the duplexer saves on loss here and makes a big difference to overall efficiency. A yet better way to do things for constant envelope modulation is to use a direct modulation phase lock loop as shown here. The phase lock loop consists of a variable modulus divider that is driven by a sigma delta modulator that will cause this division ratio to modulate in a particular sequence so that very fine frequency resolution can be obtained here. Not only then can this be used to set the output channel frequency to exactly where it should be, but by modulating the sigma delta modulator here and therefore the divider, the frequency shift modulation can be directly imposed by the loop itself because this is such fine resolution. Therefore, we get a signal at the output of the VCO, which is centered on the desired channel and subject to the GMSK modulation directly. Now, this is a pure digital solution. There are no mixers involved, there are no D2A converters, and there are no amplifiers except the power amplifier itself. The phase lock loop works off a standard crystal, and pure digital data goes into a CMOS digital circuit that modulates a digital divider. So not only is it convenient and compact, but it is robust fundamentally because you can never get the parasitic amplitude modulation. The output power is controlled independently at the power amplifier. So this is the latest trend in constant envelope modulators. Now let's talk about power amplifiers in general. Power amplifiers have been divided into various classes. The power amplifier looks like this. It's essentially a single transistor with some way of getting a bias into it, some form of impedance matching and filtering driving the antenna load. The class A power amplifier is the simplest and most linear of all. It achieves a peak efficiency of 50% at maximum output, and the efficiency declines with increasing peak to average ratio. In a class A type amplifier, the voltage and the current waveforms faithfully reproduce the input signal. So in the case of a sine wave, they would look like this through this transistor, where VD is instantaneous voltage, ID is instantaneous current. In a class B amplifier, we still have overall linearity, and we can get higher efficiency than class A at high peak to average ratios. That efficiency can be as large as 78%. In this case, the transistor conducts only for half a cycle at a time. That's why it's called class B. And the output power can be regularized by the filtering action or by complementary action. In class C amplifiers, striving for higher efficiency, the idea is to let the transistor conduct for even shorter fractions of the half cycle, because as you can see, as the voltage across the transistor diminishes towards zero, if the transistor conducts at that time, the dissipation in the transistor itself will be close to zero because that's the product of these two waveforms. This is only suited to constant envelope waveforms. The other extreme is to go to class D, where we pretend that we can make a perfect switch instead of a real transistor that switches either to the supply or to ground. And again, the filtering action will take out current, which is at the fundamental frequency, which would be sine wave-like. This would ideally deliver 100% efficiency, except for the practical problems of making a switch at RF. So as a result, when we start to make real switches and out of transistors and deal with the issues of the real-life capacitances there, we move on to Class E type amplifiers, where we try to absorb the drain capacitance at this point into the switching waveform, making the switching waveform look more like this in the presence of capacitance, and again, the transistor conducting for half a cycle. It's striving for high efficiency. While the transistor is conducting, the voltage across it is zero, so the dissipation inside the transistor is small. All the power is being delivered to the output. However, again, this is not the optimal solution. So to come back towards the ideal switch, one can use harmonic resonators, in particular odd harmonics, to build up this pulse-like waveforms back towards a square wave, and that leads to a class F. Now, this briefly is just a taxonomy of the various things that are being looked at. let's see how some of these more efficient amplifiers might be used to deliver linear modulations to the antenna. One possibility is to build a transmitter based on polar modulation, and this is very much at the state of the art of research today. The idea is to decompose a variable envelope waveform into an envelope-only waveform and a phase-only waveform. All of this decomposition can be done in DSP, so this is a DSP-intensive solution. The idea then is to use a nonlinear amplifier, let's say like a Class D or Class E amplifier, which is very efficient but can only modulate phase and cannot follow envelope fluctuations. And so to deliver the phase-only waveform to this, so which it amplifies with high efficiency, and then to superimpose the envelope modulations by controlling, let us say, the power supply of this transistor through a wideband DC to DC converter that takes amplitude information from this D2A converter and essentially converts it into a supply voltage that tracks that, but this supply voltage is capable of efficiently converting a fixed battery voltage to a variable supply voltage here. As the supply voltage goes up and down on the saturated amplifier, so does the instantaneous amplitude. Now, in principle, this sounds very good, and the decomposition would be specified by these equations, and it can be seen that the output after recomposition would deliver exactly the arbitrary waveform that we wanted to create. However, the nonlinear transforms of envelope-only and phase-only paths tend to expand the bandwidth of the baseband signals often to large multiples of what they are to begin with. This makes these paths quite challenging because they have to be very wideband, in particular this DC to DC converter. Furthermore, mismatch in the delays from the phase information to the envelope information can cause distortion, and these remain difficult problems to solve. Now let's move on to wireless receivers. The challenge of wireless reception is that we are trying to receive weak signals, as shown by this black phasor here, in the presence of noise and in the presence of unwanted strong signals. Unlike wireline communication, where all signals tend to have comparable power, in the wireless domain, because of near-far effects, fading, and so on, signals can have vastly different levels. And the wireless receiver designer always plans on the fact that the signal of interest is weak and close to noise and is accompanied by unwanted signals that are much stronger, that may be coming from a nearby unit that you're not interested in listening to. Now, in the presence of nonlinearity in the receiver, we see many effects, and the most important one is that of third-order intermodulation, where two large unwanted signals can create effectively sidebands arising from third-order intermodulation, where the sidebands may drop onto the desired signal of interest. And although these are being sent in different channels than the wanted signal, in the receiver, all these signals are initially received before these are filtered out, and the distortion product of these can wipe out the desired signal before these have been removed. This issue of contending with large signals and with noise is best specified by the spurious-free dynamic range of the receiver. This is characterized by measuring the receiver response to the fundamental signal of interest here and to third-order intermodulation caused by adjacent channels as shown here as a function of input. The output then is measured due to these two effects, and where this the extrapolated output intercept is called the third order intercept point, and the spirosphere dynamic range is defined by that level of the input where the third order intermodulation product becomes comparable to noise. In other words, the deleterious effects or the damaging effects of intermodulation and of noise are comparable at this point. And the spirosphere dynamic range is the fundamental response relative to that point there. Now, as we lower the supply voltage in our integrated circuits dictated by technology, the spirosphere dynamic range will inevitably shrink. That's pretty obvious. If you can swing a signal from 0 to VDD, the supply voltage, and the supply voltage goes down because the transistors cannot stand the high voltages, the maximum swing is diminished, and as a result, distortion sets in earlier, and the a differential amplifier characteristic like this shrinks, lowering the extent of the linear region and causing the intercept point and spirosphere dynamic range to go down. And this is one of the biggest challenges in designing and scale technologies today. Now let's talk about spirosphere dynamic range at the transistor level briefly, and there'll be much more discussion in the subsequent lectures. Let's start with FETs. In a MOSFET in saturation, most simply is defined by a square law characteristic, where the current is proportional to the effective gate voltage squared, where the effective gate voltage is the actual VGS above threshold voltage. From this, it follows that the transconductance, small signal, is given by 2 times the bias current over the effective gate voltage. Now, we can look at a noise in terms of this transconductance. If the FET noise is simply the thermal noise, which is mainly the issue in the receiver front end, it's represented by an equivalent input noise voltage whose spectral density is 4 kT gamma divided by the transconductance. And in terms of this simple expression is 2 kT gamma V effective over I. On the other hand, the transistor alone suffers from third order distortion. Now this may not be apparent from the simple expression, but the main reason for this is that the mobility of this transistor is a function of electric field. And that produces a third order coefficient associated with a single transistor. For an N MOSFET, this gives the input referred intercept point in voltage as a function of the bias voltage here. And you can see that on the semi-log plot, this is roughly linear. Similarly, for P MOSFETs. From this, we can deduce that, roughly speaking, the log of the intercept point is proportional to the effective gate voltage. Now, the spirosphere dynamic range is roughly the ratio of the intercept point to the noise level. So it's the ratio of these two things. And strictly speaking, it should be raised to the power 2/3 from the graph in the previous slide. So if we look at that, the ratio of IP3, which depends on V effective, and the noise spectral density, which depends on V effective over I, the ratio is proportional to I to the power 2/3. Now, the most important thing to be drawn, this conclusion to be drawn from this rough relationship, is that the spirosphere dynamic range of a single transistor depends on the bias current independent of the bias voltage, and most importantly, independent of channel length. So, as long as the FT is satisfactory and parasitics are not the limiting issue, the spurious-free dynamic range of a transistor depends on how much current it consumes, independent of its geometry, its size, and in particular, its channel length. Now, let's compare this to a bipolar transistor. For a bipolar transistor with its exponential junction characteristic, the raw input transistor input-referred intercept point is constant, and it's roughly minus 12.3 dBm, referred to 50 ohms. The noise in the transistor is, for many practical applications, set by its base spreading resistance, RB prime. Now, this alone would not be good enough for many practical applications, and so the intention is to somehow improve the nonlinearity in the front end when we're dealing with these large signals, and that is often done with resistor degeneration. So the bipolar transistor is highly nonlinear, but has a high transconductance, and we can trade off the transconductance for linearity with resistor degeneration. And let's just compare a resistively degenerated simple building block circuit like a differential pair with a MOSFET circuit that does effectively the same thing. In these two cases, these two circuits have been designed to give roughly the same linear portion, large signal linear portion of their transconductance characteristic, large signal transconductance. So if I apply a large sine wave here to these two FETs and sense the output differentially, I get a characteristic that looks like this, which has a linear region that is limited by 2 times the effective gate voltage. Whereas in the bipolar transistor, with degeneration, the linear region is limited by the IR drop, I times R of the degeneration. Now, in this case, we see that the effective transconductance we get in this case, which is the small signal transconductance, is roughly 2 over R, where R is reference to this. And that is the same thing is true here, because with degeneration, the resistor controls noise. So in this particular instance, the dynamic range of these two circuits is, in fact, comparable, because if we set VGS, this quantity here, equal to that, this ensues. And as a result, if you recall, the noise depends upon the effective GM after degeneration. The linearity is comparable to begin with. So the ratio of noise to linearity is comparable. So therefore, to the first order, there is nothing really to distinguish one type of transistor from another when all is said and done. However, in special cases, the higher FT of the bipolar transistor compared to the MOSFET can be valuable. The lower parasitics in some other respects can be valuable. And so for special purposes, there are certain distinctive features. Now, the example I gave you is one of moving dynamic range through scaling or degeneration, and this is used extensively in real-life receiver design. I mentioned that the dynamic range of an FET depends only on bias current. So, supposing we have an FET of a certain size with an effective gate voltage and a certain bias current. It gives us a dynamic range specified on the lower end by noise, on the upper end by IP3. Now, supposing the same transistor is to be used further down in the receiver chain, where the signals have been amplified, in particular the unwanted signals have been amplified but not yet removed, so we need higher linearity as we move down the chain. Now, this can be achieved in the following way. If we take the same transistor and shrink it in size, in W over L ratio, while keeping its length the same here usually, increase its effective gate voltage so that the current is the same as before, the dynamic range remains unchanged, but after shrinking, the noise level grows, and so does the IP3. The IP3 grows because it depends only on effective gate voltage. So in this way, we can, at constant current, we can slide the dynamic range up and down depending on where the transistor is to be used in the receive chain. And this is a very simple and systematic way to design and scale transistors as we proceed down the chain. On the other hand, at times it may be the case that for a given current, the dynamic range we obtain is simply insufficient for the use. The dynamic range is set by system level considerations, not by circuits. The circuits are supposed to conform to the system requirements. Well, in this case, one thing that can be done is, keeping effective gate voltage constant, we can scale up the transistor, which would mean more current. As a result, the dynamic range will go up, and in this particular case, with constant V effective, IP3 will stay constant, noise will become lower. This is an example of sliding dynamic range, this is an example of scaling. In both instances, the dynamic range is roughly independent of channel length. Now, in a receiver, we have a cascade of several blocks which amplify the signal, add noise to it, and subject it to various degrees of non-linearity. Each block is characterized by its gain, its noise factor, and its IP3 in this chain. There's a small error here, this should be F3. The cascade noise factor was seen at the input through this chain is given roughly by this equation, which is accounting for the fact that the noise at the input of this block is divided by the gain of the preceding block when you refer it back to the input, and thus this gain appears here. Similarly, the cascade nonlinearity is given by this chain expression, and that says that as the signal is amplified more, it drives the following stages harder, and so therefore the intercept point of the following stages matters more in this particular form of expression. So what is to be seen here is that for good overall dynamic range, as seen at the input, it's not enough to design a single low-noise amplifier and make it look good. You have to worry about the entire receiver. to make the whole receiver look good, we have to use this sliding dynamic range idea, where as the signal progresses, the dynamic range slides up, and this is done by device scaling, and often, if it's not done systematically, often we can end up wasting current where it's not really necessary to do so. Let's now turn to receiver architectures and some of the attractions for high levels of integration as well as the problems that arise. This is an example of a zero IF direct conversion receiver used to detect frequency shift keying. The signal of interest is filtered at the antenna to cast out unwanted bands, and several channels that lie inside the band of interest enter the low noise amplifier. Then the channel of interest is directly selected by tuning a local oscillator in quadrature phases exactly to the middle of the channel of interest. This mixes down the channel of interest as a difference frequency at the output to zero intermediate frequency, and adjacent channels are situated either side of zero. That means that adjacent channels lie both on positive frequencies and on negative frequencies. And the only way those can be distinguished is with this quadrature paths, as I'll explain in the following slides. Now, a low-pass filter can focus in on the channel of interest around zero and strip off all the adjacent channels. A simple, active, on-chip low-pass filter can do that job. And then if all we're sensing is frequency shift keying, limiting amplifiers is sufficient before we enter a digital detector. This could be the entire receiver, and you can see this very, very simple indeed. It's highly integrable. Aside from this, everything else can be fully on-chip. It's low power. There are very moderate requirements in image rejection. Again, I'll talk about that in a second. And the filtering can be on chip, and it can be a high order filter that does not populate any board space. It's built on chip. Now, why quadrature phases? If we have a signal centered at the LO frequency, so this is the LO frequency, here is the channel of interest, and we down convert it to zero IF, then at zero IF, the right half part of the signal spectrum lies in positive frequencies. This becomes zero, and the left half part of the spectrum lies on negative frequencies. How can positive and negative frequencies be distinguished? Well, the only way to distinguish them is by exploiting these trigonometric properties that if we take a modulated waveform here and there and look at its sine wave multiplying by a sine wave of the local oscillator, we get terms like this. Whereas if we take the same signal and multiply it by the cosine phase of the local oscillator, we get terms like that. Now, the important thing here is that when we look at the cosine term, it doesn't care whether it's looking at a positive or negative frequencies, the outcome is always positive. Whereas the sine term does flip its sign if we have a negative frequency versus a positive one. This can be represented as phases like this, that one part of this spectrum to the right will result in a cosine and a sine shown by these phases with this relative orientation, whereas in the other part, the sine will flip over. So if we can make circuits that can distinguish between these kinds of phasor quadrature sets, or sequences as they're called, then we can tell the difference between positive and negative frequencies. And this is why quadrature mixing with quadrature phases is essential at zero IF, or anywhere else where one has to make this kind of distinction. There are circuits that respond differently to the counterclockwise and clockwise orientations of these sequences, and they are called polyphase circuits or Hilbert filters. Now, there are some other problems at zero IF. This is a very attractive scheme for high levels of integration. First of all, after the signal has been down-converted, it is amplified and filtered at baseband with on-chip integrated circuits. All of these circuits suffer from offsets. The offsets, in spite of the fact that we can design out systematic offsets by using fully differential signal paths, there are still random transistor mismatches that will cause DC offsets, and the small signal that has been received and mildly amplified by the low noise amplifier is competing with a DC offset that lies right in the middle of the signal spectrum. This becomes very difficult to deal with. In addition, in CMOS in particular, there is 1 over F noise that will rise towards the center of this down-converted signal and corrupt or degrade its signal-to-noise ratio. And that, too, must be somehow dealt with in a reasonable way. Otherwise, the received signal to noise ratio will be much worse than we thought. Now, DC offset in a direct conversion receiver is not a simple static problem. It's obviously ever present in baseband circuits, but we can also see dynamic offsets arising from various forms of parasitic self-mixing. For instance, if we have a local oscillator here that goes to, can be tuned to various frequencies, its output is meant to drive the LO input of this mixer and this one. It is possible, due to stray capacitive coupling, for part of this local oscillator signal, which by the way is a very strong signal on chip, to couple into the output of the low noise amplifier and mix with itself. If a frequency mixes with itself, it creates DC. And this DC can vary as we tune the oscillator to different channels. So it's no longer a matter of dealing with a constant DC, predicting it once, calibrating it once, and subtracting it. We must constantly track it. Also, it is possible for the local oscillator signal to couple independently into the antenna through parasitic means and actually be broadcast out of the antenna as an unwanted fixed tone that could reflect off some distant object and come back to the same antenna and be received through the low noise amplifier and self-mix, again causing a DC. Now, as these dynamic objects outside the receiver change their relative position, or as you move around the handset, the DC changes because the amount that comes back changes, and this causes a dynamic problem. Now, one simple way, effectively this is the only way to deal with DC offsets, is by imposing a notch at 0 hertz. This can be done through analog means, as shown here, or through digital means by using a digital signal processor to estimate the DC offset and then use a D2A converter to subtract it out. In any case, what this means is that if you have, for instance, a chain of baseband amplifiers with low frequency feedback pods, the feedback suppresses the gain in the amplifiers at low frequencies within the pass band of this RC circuit. Whereas at higher frequencies, the feedback disappears and you see the full gain of the amplifiers. This kind of per-stage DC offset cancellation is often used because it not only cancels gives very low gain to incoming DC, but it also cancels the offset of each stage rather than letting it get amplified. This could be any baseband circuit with gain in the baseband part of the receiver. Now let's look at the implications on noise. If we have a DC notch that essentially kills the gain exactly at DC, but permits the most of the signal spectrum, which occupies some finite bandwidth, to go through, it would amount to effectively a band pass filter like this, where here is the DC notch, then here's the pass band, where all these circuits carry the desired signal, and eventually the channel select filter strips off the adjacent channels that lie to the right. The noise that falls within the pass band of this effective band pass filter, right, touching or backed up against DC here, this is what will finally determine the signal noise ratio. If this is 1/f noise specified by the spectrum, then the final mean square value of noise that goes out is determined by the log of the ratio of the upper to the lower cutoff frequency here. And this gives us a handle on limiting how much flicker noise goes into the receiver. Now let's look at how this notch filtering would apply to some real-life waveforms. We'll start with a very simple waveform that would be used only, for example, in paging receivers and so on, which is binary FSK, frequency shift keying. The frequency centered at the carrier frequency here is shifted by data 1 to the right, data 0 to the left. And as a result, the output spectrum has two peaks separated from the center carrier frequency. Now clearly, after down conversion to 0 IF, there is no harm if you put a DC offset, a DC null right at the center of this channel, which is centered at DC, because there's no valuable signal spectral energy there. And as long as the pass band of the resulting filter captures the peak values of the spectrum, we recover most of the spectral energy, and therefore the signal. This can also apply to four-level FSK. However, as we go to more advanced modulation schemes, such as Gaussian frequency shift keying used in Bluetooth with a very small modulation index, no longer is it the case that in the middle of the channel, the spectrum goes through a dip. In fact, the spectrum peaks at the middle of the channel. Now, if we down-convert this to 0 hertz, then this would be a snapshot of the down-converted spectrum starting from 0 going towards the right. This is one half of the spectrum, the remaining is to the left. It is still possible to apply DC offset nulling in this way, and this shows this little notch here, where although we have removed valuable signal spectrum from the peak, we've also obviously eliminated DC, we can still recover the signal with an adequate bit error rate. For example, with a 19 kilohertz wide notch centered at DC, we can still read this signal with a 10 to the minus 3 bit error rate, which is good enough for Bluetooth. So this is of broad application to variety of spectra. In addition, in these very compact zero IF receivers, there is the new issue of second order distortion. The signal of interest will down convert to DC. It will be accompanied by various other signals that will eventually be stripped off by the filter, but initially will be received in the receiver and even amplified. Now, if there's any second order distortion, and one of those adjacent signals happens to have amplitude modulation, the second order distortion detects the amplitude modulation and creates a composite of two spectra like this, due to this one, which are centered exactly at DC. So therefore, this second order distortion arising from a strong unwanted AM channel can wipe out the signal of interest that has been down converted to DC. This happens in the baseband part of the receiver before channel selection. Also, if we happen to have two tones, second order distortion will cause the difference frequency between the two tones to appear close to DC. Now, this applies wherever these channels may lie, anywhere in the passband of the receiver. So if you have multiple such signals, they all contribute their products and they accumulate at DC, overcoming the desired signal. This is obviously highly undesirable. So although we can null DC offset as I described, this remains a problem. Now, what is the origin of this? We could design our circuits to be all balanced, that is, differential in, differential out, and balanced circuits ideally have a distortion that is third order and fifth order, and all even order products appear only as common mode and are rejected. So an ideal balanced circuit has no second order distortion. However, when we recognize that when making these out of practical transistors, imbalance can be caused principally by the presence of DC offsets. That means offsets in the transistors themselves, mismatch in threshold voltages, or other forms of mismatch. And that is represented by this input offset here. Now, if we take the same third order expression but include offset, a new term pops up which produces a differential output that depends upon the square of the input voltage. This is the cause of second order distortion in a balanced circuit. And there is an effective IP2, second order intercept point, that is inversely proportional to this offset. So if the offset were not there, this would be infinite. And it's related to the third order intercept point in this fashion, that VIP2 is equal to VIP3 squared divided by 4 times the offset. Now, how do we deal with this? Well, we can scale our transistors to lower the mismatch between halves of a balanced circuit, but that is only possible to a certain extent before other factors limit that. A more useful circuit technique is to use feedback. Negative feedback is normally used to linearize any circuit. In a differential circuit, it would tend to linearize or lower the third order distortion. Now, it can be shown that when it lowers the third order distortion by that previous relationship, the second order distortion is also lowered. And in particular, if we have a feedback factor of beta with a forward gain of A1, the IP2 after feedback in the presence of offset is equal to the original IP2 multiplied by 1 plus the loop gain to the power 3. So it's a very strong way of raising the IP2 or suppressing second order distortion. Now let's turn to 1/f noise. In a direct conversion receiver, the signal is down converted to a zero IF, and so 1/f noise after down conversion will degrade the signal noise ratio as I described. We can never make 1/f noise go away. It can only be lowered by design. The most troublesome source of 1/f noise is the mixer itself, because CMOS mixers, like shown here, will create 1/f noise at their output directly due to 1/f noise in these switching transistors. And unlike baseband circuits, which are relatively low frequency circuits where transistors can be sized up in gate area to lower 1/f noise, here we have no such option because these switching devices are driven by the local oscillator frequency, which is 900 megahertz up to 5 gigahertz, and these must be kept very small always. So their output flicker noise is always large and degrades the signal to noise ratio right there. One possible way to avoid flicker noise and also DC offset is to use low IF instead of zero IF to take the signal of interest, which is here accompanied by unwanted channels, and position our local oscillator away from it so that the difference frequency after mixing down positions the signal of interest away from DC and away from the peak of the 1/f noise. So in this way, we can contain the effects of 1/f noise and not worry about notching out signal spectrum when we remove DC offset. However, we immediately inherit a new problem. To the right of this channel are these channels, which have also been down-converted and which will be removed by a filter later. But to the left of these channels are other channels which are also down-converted, and from here onwards, these channels will down-convert onto negative frequencies. When we look at it on a simple frequency axis, the negative frequencies will fold over on top of the positive ones so that these adjacent channels will overlap. They were originally designed to be adjacent, but after down conversion, they overlap the desired channel. You can see that this dashed channel lies at the same frequency as the desired one and, in fact, is stronger than it. This requires on-chip image rejection, and that's a totally new set of problems. So let me talk about circuits that reject the image. We want to develop circuits that will pass all the frequencies on the positive frequency axis and will null out frequencies that lie on negative frequency axis. Now, we're all familiar with a DC notch, as I described earlier. It's a simple capacitive circuit, a CR circuit like this one. It doesn't allow DC to go through, notches DC, but allows higher frequencies to go past like so. Now, this simple circuit can be made into a image-sensitive circuit by using the shift transform. If we take the S variable, which is the Laplace variable, and replace it with S plus j omega naught, where omega naught is where we'd like to null a negative frequency, then replacing it in the transfer function here causes the transfer function to shift so that the notch now lies at this negative frequency. And so this would be good because if there's an undesired signal, unwanted adjacent channel, which becomes an image lying here, it would be notched out, whereas the desired signal here will be passed. So we look at this single frequency notching circuit for a moment. The way this is done is by taking the equations that describe the circuit, replacing S by S plus j omega, and that expands out to this circuit here, which consists of the C and the R in these four branches, where the branches are driven by the differential signal, input signal, and by quadrature versions of the input signal as well. And they're cross-coupled in this fashion, in this systematic way. It can be shown that these control sources can be stripped off while preserving all of this value. So it just becomes a simple RC circuit that notches out one negative frequency, which is given by the RC time constant, and it passes all other frequencies. Here's another way to draw the same circuit that I described earlier. And when we subject it to arbitrary inputs, it can be analyzed purely geometrically in the following way. If these inputs happen to lie at the RC frequency of this systematic circuit, and there are four arbitrary phases with arbitrary magnitudes and phases, we can decompose them into two sequences: a counterclockwise sequence, which is all balanced and at 90 degrees with respect to each other, a clockwise sequence, balanced but in the opposite orientation, and antiphase and in-phase sequences. And the simple analysis tells us that one of these sequences lies on negative frequencies and is nulled out by this, the other lies in positive frequencies and is passed by this, and these two other residual sequences are common mode and are rejected differentially. So only one of these sequences passes. This has all kinds of practical uses. For example, if we take an oscillator with differential output and apply it to one of these RC polyphase filters, so that we tie together pairwise the four inputs into one pair of inputs, then the input stimuli are represented by these two antiphase phases, which is the differential output here. They can be decomposed into the sum of two opposite sequences. One of these sequences is nulled at the output, the other one passes. If the other one passes, that means the output consists of balanced quadrature outputs. So using this simple technique, we can convert balanced to balanced quadrature, and this is of value. This is used in image rejection circuits, as shown here, where we take quadrature phases of the incoming signal and multiply it by the LO, or the incoming signal alone and multiply it by quadrature phases of LO, and then use one of these polyphase circuits such that the desired signal lies in one sequence, the image signal lies in the opposite sequence, and the polyphase circuit strips off the image after mixing. There are some limitations to this on-chip image rejection. This is obviously an issue of integration, and there are some limitations on this. the amount of image rejection we can get depends upon the precision of our components. You have quadrature paths which stimulate this polyphase filter. Any mismatch in those paths arising from component mismatch will limit how much the unwanted image is notched. So if, for example, one is looking for 60 dB of image suppression, which is a very aggressive target, one would need the quadrature phases to be accurate to 0.1 degree. And the gains in the quadrature paths, which amounts to component matching in the two quadrature paths, to be within 0.02 dB of each other. Very hard to do, but not impossible. Now, these quadrature ideas can be used to synthesize various ways of rejecting the image on chip so that we can eliminate all external filters for image rejection that were found in conventional radio receivers. Let me just run through some basics here, and then we'll see how they're put together. So here's the problem we're dealing with. At an incoming frequency, we have a desired signal and we have an image. After simple mixing, both of these will lie on top of each other because we cannot distinguish positive and negative frequencies. However, if we mix with quadrature phases of the local oscillator to some intermediate frequency, the desired signal creates quadrature outputs at these two outputs, which are in one sequence, and the image creates the opposite sequence, both lying at the same frequency. Now, if we put this into a polyphase filter, it'll pass this and null that. On the other hand, if we are doing something like a transmitter, or just in general, if we have quadrature phases of the input available, and we mix them together with quadrature phases of the LO and add them like so, here are some of the properties. if the LO frequency is here, and we apply an input which is LO plus IF, that input down converts the output into the IF frequency. However, if the input frequency were unchanged, but the sequence were reversed, it would upconvert to 2 times the LO frequency. Similarly, if we have an image here which lies below the LO, after this mixing, it downconverts to IF, which is the desired signal, and it downconverts in the same phase as the desired one. But if the image were flipped, it would upconvert to 2 times the LO frequency. Usually, it is these things that we focus on in a receiver. Here are some variations on it. What I've done is flip the sequence of the desired signals in this case, and here we find that when we flip the sequence of the desired signals are upconverted, and these other dashed signals are downconverted to the IF. In this particular case, because of the change in sequence, they downconvert into antiphase. If we reverse the sign, instead of addition, we subtract, then we flip the situation over. The two signals that were upconverted will now downconvert to IF, and the other two will upconvert. And all of these are very useful properties to make fully integrated receivers. So now let's look at the simplest possible image reject single conversion receiver that would be used in a low IF type situation. Here is the desired signal, the incoming frequency band. Here's the desired signal. Here's the image we have to contend with. We tune the LO frequency in the middle so that the difference between here is the desired IF. The desired signal produces these phases. The image signal appears at the same frequency but in opposite sequence. And we use a polyphase filter, which could be active or passive, to simply pass the desired signal and null that. So it's a way of doing image rejection right away using fully integrated R's and C's. This is a dual conversion receiver. Often we have to down convert to first one IF and then to a second one. There are all kinds of practical reasons why this is necessary. This dual conversion receiver is built using the components I showed earlier, and I'm not going to walk through all the details of this, but there is an issue of the image at the first down conversion to a first IF and then a second image to the second IF. And this too can be dealt with here, so that at the output we have the desired signal in one sequence, a secondary image in the opposite sequence, and everything else is upconverted. And then using a Hilbert filter here, we can pull out only the desired signal. Okay, now, yes, I saw that. So these ideas can be applied to wide band to encompass different channel bandwidths by staggering RC sections at a different notch points. Instead of notching only one frequency, we can have a set of frequencies that are notched here, which can, across this wide band, reject the a wide channel by some desired amount. I don't want to spend too much time on the details of building these polyphase filters, aside from making some important component-level observations. The final image rejection depends on component matching. The image rejection inverse is proportional to the spreads in resistors and capacitors. So if you're making four branches of R's and C's, an important consideration is how well they can match on chip. And for 60 dB image rejection, we need 0.1% matching. There are also issues of parasitic capacitances associated with these resistors that will limit the amount of image rejection. these polyphase circuits, if they are multiple stage, tend to lower the signal as the signal propagates through there, and so we have to be conscious of that. Their input impedance is a strong function of frequency, so they have to be driven appropriately, and they can saturate the previous mixer if they're not driven properly. There is the issue of noise due to resistors in these on-chip image rejection circuits that must be properly accounted for. And they must be terminated well so that the four branches remain well balanced to provide the image rejection. We can extend this to active polyphase filters. Instead of using R's and C's only, we can make a low-pass filter like this with a proper multi-high-order characteristic. And that, too, can have this shifted characteristic where it passes a desired channel and rejects adjacent channels here and image channels here. And I'll show an example of this in just 1 second. And when we make these active filters, we have to be conscious of noise in the active devices like op-amps accumulating. So we have to make sure that as they go through the filter, we amplify the signal as it proceeds and attenuate the interferers so that the noise due to the op-amps does not accumulate, but rather we have progressive improvement in signal noise ratio. Okay, we're running short of time, so I'd just like to point out some key features of a fully integrated GSM receiver for 900 megahertz in 0.35 micron CMOS, where these ideas have been put to test. This is just the background to it. The big challenge in GSM receivers is that the desired signal is very weak. It can be as low as minus 100 dBm, and it's accompanied by progressively stronger signals that can be as large as 100 dB higher than the desired one. These signals enter the receiver, and if we are not using any intermediate external off-chip filters, they are subject to nonlinearity and harmonic mixing in the receiver, and the receiver must be designed to be tolerant to all of that. The idea was to use a low IF approach because GSM bandwidth is only 200 kilohertz. And if we put a notch in the middle of it, we can remove valuable spectral energy. So the idea was to down-convert to a low IF of 120 kilohertz and then deal with the image rejection of the left side negative frequency channels separately. Now, one of the other issues is that for rejecting harmonic mixing through the input LO and also for improving flicker noise, it is desirable not to directly down-convert to 120 kilohertz, but to do so progressively, first from the 950 megahertz to 190 and then to 120 kilohertz. And that leads to this fully integrated receiver, which shows some of the familiar elements I described. That is a low noise amplifier, quadrature mixing so we can deal with images, a passive polyphase filter to strip off the images, amplification here, then this is at 190 megahertz and completely on chip, then down conversion to a 120 kilohertz low IF where we can do most of our amplification easily because these are low frequency circuits, and also do our channel selection and image rejection in an active polyphase filter. Again, highly integrated, and it uses one VCO to drive both mixers. I'm not going to go through the details because these are just circuit level issues, but a simple amplifier like this with only two external matching elements here, and these are bond wire inductors for impedance matching. This is a well-known topology with adjustable gain is used. This is an on-chip 8.7 nanohenry inductor. We amplify the signal by up to 24 dB with a noise figure of 1.6 dB at 900 megahertz. Everything works off 2.5 volts. Then these CMOS mixers are used. They take a total of 4 milliamps, followed by the passive polyphase filter I described earlier for image rejection. This combination of front-end LNA and mixer delivers good results. We get a total gain of about 20 dB at 950 megahertz and good matching with a total composite cascade noise figure of 3.4 dB, and the noise figure is higher because of the mixers, obviously. Then after down conversion to 190 megahertz, the signal is amplified in these somewhat easier but still somewhat challenging amplifiers, and then down converted by second mixers to our low IF of 120 kilohertz. Now this active polyphase filter is required to do this. The signal of interest is this red one here, that lies in the pass band and it's centered at 120 kilohertz. And then these adjacent channels to the left are negative channels, minus one and minus two, become images. An active polyphase filter will, instead of passing them, will subject them to its tail, which goes into the negative frequency domain, so they see a much lower gain as given by this blue tail here. And that gives us a 35 dB image rejection with a fifth order Chebyshev active polyphase filter. This is how the filter is made. It's an RC filter with real polysilicon resistors and switchable capacitors for tuning. That gives very high linearity, and we can also embed 60 dB of gain at 120 kilohertz IF easily. The voltage-controlled oscillator, the local oscillator, is fully integrated and meets the GSM phase noise specifications. It oscillates at 1140 megahertz for upper side injection, and here the GSM receive phase noise specification and meets all of those using a very moderate current of 3.4 milliamps and fully integrated on-chip spiral inductors. It's not enough to build an oscillator. You have to create quadrature phases to drive your quadrature mixers as well as buffer it into the mixers. And the buffers are themselves quite challenging designs with the inductor loads and a polyphase filter for quadrature creation from balanced outputs. These, again, take moderate amounts of current. This, finally, is the receiver chip photograph. I'll just spend a moment talking about this. Here is our local low-noise amplifier with its on-chip inductor. These are inductors from the local oscillator buffers that take quadrature phases of the 1140 megahertz and mix the output of the low noise amplifier in these mixers. This then goes into on-chip polyphase filter for image stripping and then the programmable gain amplifiers at the first IF of 190 megahertz. And then it's down converted to 120 kilohertz here again with polyphase filters and mixers. Then here is where we do all of our channel select filtering, image rejection, and baseband amplification. These are op amps, and these are capacitor arrays that are required for tuning, and the size of the capacitor sets the noise level. This is the on-chip VCO, and these are the inductors that tune the VCO, and these are used for the buffers. So you can see inductors occupy a lot of chip area. This is the final receiver performance. It passes the desired channel here, rejects the image by 37 dB in the adjacent channels, and it has a noise figure that starts from 4 dB at 250 kHz, and because of 1 over F noise and proper design, it rises to only 6 kHz at 25 kHz offset. We can get 60 dB of gain at baseband in the passband. And we can tolerate our blockers, that is, if we're subjected to unwanted signals, we get lots of image rejection by design on chip. Blockers are rejected by 106 dB plus, which is a very important spec. So, in summary, we have a fully integrated receiver with on-chip image rejection and dual conversion using the ideas I've described. And it's all been engineered properly for 1 over F noise, matching, etc., to get all the specs. 5 dB noise figure, minus 16 dBm IP3, 24 milliamp current consumption, plus 8 milliamp for the LO generator in 0.35 micron CMOS. And so lastly, proper choice of architecture, a comprehension of device level issues, of component issues, and of fundamental sort of building blocks and how best to tailor them can give you very compelling, interesting solutions in a very integrated context. And I think this poses lots of good challenges for technologists. And I think when you sort of put this together with some of the other things you'll hear at the transistor level and so on, I think it lays out sort of what the wireless application demands from IC technologies today. Thank you very much.